This is Senator Roxanne J. Persaud, representing the 19th Senatorial District, and this is the legislative report from Albany. Today we will talk about the passage of the budget. After months of negotiation, the budget was passed on April 1st. There are many things in the budget that we can talk about, but today we will focus on education and the paid family leave aspect of the budget. It's a historic budget. And here with me today to talk about this historic aspect of the budget is Louis Tobias, Financial Director of the Senate Democratic Conference. Louis, thank you for being here today.
Thank you for having me, Senator Persaud.
So tell me a little about who you are in the Senate Conference.
Well, in my position as Finance Director of the Senate, all bills that have fiscal implications have to go through the Finance Committee. And I'm the director of the staff that staffs that committee. Currently, Senator Liz Krueger is a ranking member on that, and the budget is a financial document, so my staff and I evaluate the budget along with any other bill that has any financial implication.
I just want to let you know, I really appreciate the work your staff does. I've called upon them a number of times, and they've always been willing to assist me, and so I commend you for the staff you have.
Thank you. They work very hard.
They really do. Could you tell us about the educational aspect of the budget? The budget, you know, we know a budget has the largest component of the budget is health care and education. Can you tell us about the education component?
Well, as you mentioned, it's a $155+ billion budget with over $20 billion of that coming from education and health care, making up the significant components. But this year in the budget, you and your colleagues were able to achieve a historic funding level for education for all the schools across the state. The governor put in a particular budget and you added over $1.5 billion to that budget. You eliminated the GEA as well as increased foundation aid. And in doing so, and for New York City in particular, their section of the portion of the budget was about $9.7 billion. And of that, there was a $525 million increase. Approximately $75 million for community schools and things of that sort. So the funding levels for education within the budget this year are historic and have never been seen before. And hopefully it'll translate into making it down to the classroom and able to educate all of New York students.
We're hoping so. You talked about community schools and the funding that we're giving to community schools. How much is an increase? Can you tell me approximately?
About $75 million is what we gave for the community schools. Now, there are foundation aid levels and there are other funding within the budget that would allow for the state education department as well as the New York City education department to be able to allocate funding for community schools. But this is the amount that is specifically allocated for community schools. There are other funding pots that would be eligible to be directed to community schools, mm-hmm. but $75 million is the part that's specifically allocated
from that budget.
From that budget, yes, ma'am.
That's an amazing amount because we know, you know, our schools need a lot. Not only the community schools, but the traditional schools.
Yes.
The traditional schools are looking for, you know, there was the CFE funding that's owed to that. And I think with the amount of money that's been allocated for, it will go a long way in getting our students the kinds of services they need in our public schools. In my district, we have a number of failing schools.
Yes,
you know, we try to not say failing schools because it stigmatizes the students. We try to say the schools there's some improvement that's
schools
needed.
Schools in need of They're, improvement,
right?
Yeah.
And it's not the school that needs improvement. It's a collective body that needs to work on the improvements for the students. And so I think this money will go a long way. And I'm hoping that the Department of Education will allocate the funds in an appropriate manner so that, you know, next year when we're fighting for the budget, we can say, see, this is the money that you've placed in the budget. You see what it's done. Let's continue to fund schools at that same level.
Absolutely.
So, and I know your staff really worked with us back and forth on that.
Nice.
Is there anything in the budget, in the funding of the education budget, that's specifically for teachers?
Well, there's lots of things. There's teacher improvement centers. There's a lot of things that will allow teachers to upgrade their skill sets. My daughter actually is a special education teacher.
Great.
And so it will allow for school districts to professional development and things of that sort. And there's tens of millions of dollars throughout the budget, specifically earmarked for upgrading teacher skill set, for allowing them to collaborate with other teachers, to attend conferences and things, to achieve new teaching methods and things of that sort. So we not only thought about just putting money mm-hmm. in the lump sum toward education, but with those specific skill sets that are necessary to improve the instruction in the classroom and to be able to share best practices from one to another. So that's also included within the budget. And those are throughout the budget, mm-hmm. both for New York City and statewide.
Did your daughter say a good job, Daddy, in the budget? When we got the budget, I think everybody was saying, good job. This is a great budget this year. Everybody, so
very
your daughter
good.
Probably said, good job, Daddy.
Very good.
So, you know, thanks for all of that on the educational aspect of the budget. Can we touch a little on the paid family leave, the historic paid family leave in New York State and the funding for that?
Well, paid family leave is one of the biggest achievements in the budget. As you know, that many families that struggle through financial crisis, it's often started because of a medical issue mm-hmm. and having to care for a sick loved one or someone going through a medical crisis. And with paid family leave, that would allow individuals who have a sick child or a sick parent that they would still be able to keep their jobs and still be able to have their income coming in. New York is one of the first in the country to establish such a program. And over the course of time, that paid family leave will allow for workers to be out of work for up to 12 weeks and to receive up to 2/3 of their salary while they're out of work. Now, that particular program is financed through a very, very, very small assessment on wages, somewhere on the order of less than a dollar per pay period. So as it ramps up, the numbers will be worked out by the Department of Financial Services, but on the order of 70 cents to start with, growing to approximately $1, $1.40 per pay period. So that's a very modest price to pay for the ability for someone to have to deal with a catastrophic medical situation in their home and allow them to continue receiving their income, continue to have their health care benefits, and continue to care for their loved ones.
How many people do you have a sense of how many people will use this in the first year?
Well, we've looked at numbers throughout California and other places and places where they've instituted some type of paid family leave program. And the estimates indicate that while it can be catastrophic for individual families, the utilization rate is not really that high. Because there are only a handful of us that have a loved one dealing with cancer or a brain mm-hmm. tumor and things of that sort. So the rates are somewhere in low single digits. 1%, 0.5% of the workforce will have to deal with a catastrophic illness or something that will require them to miss work in the first year. Mm-hmm. Now, it may affect half of the population or a third of the population over their 30-year, 40-year working career. Mm-hmm. But in any given year, the number will be anywhere from 0.5% to 1.5%.
Okay, that's good that you clarify that because there are many people who said, all of a sudden, all workers will start asking for time off, you know, under this bill. It's like, no, that's not the way it really works. Yeah. And, you know, people are really value their jobs, so they're not going to jeopardize it by deciding everybody, all the workers in the same company right. are going to be asking for time off at the same time. And as you said, it's not everyone who has a sick relative. Okay. And it has to be made for people to take the time off and to be willing to take a salary, a pay cut you're taking
yes.
when you take this time off. Yeah. It has to be something major.
Right.
It's not a frivolous illness that they will take the time off for. Yeah. And so I want people to understand that and why it's really important that New York took this step.
Absolutely.
In taking care of their workforce. You know, when you take care of your workforce, It comes back to you.
Absolutely.
Your workers are dedicated to you when you take care of them.
And they stay a long time.
They stay a long time. They really, really do. So thanks again for clarifying that.
Absolutely.
In the time that we have left, just a few minutes, can you let's touch on minimum wage, the historic 15.
The fight for 15.
The fight for 15 is finally over. Can we say it's over?
What we will say is that we've taken the first major step forward.
That's right.
So within the budget, it included an increase to the minimum wage, which in New York City will go to $15. And in the first 3 years, it'll go to $11 at the end of 2016, $13 at the end of 2017, and $15 by the end of 2018. There is a small business carve out where that will be $10.50, $12, $13.50, and $15 over the next 4 consecutive years within the city of New York. For those that may care about it, Westchester and Long Island will do the same thing, but instead of a 3-year phase in, there will be a 6-year phase in. And then outside of those communities, upstate New York, there will be a 6-year phase in, and it will go up to $12.50 in the 5th year and be indexed based upon economic indicators thereafter.
Good. Someone asked me a question this morning, like, well, you know, there's the small business provision. Mm-hmm. If you have
10 or less,
you correct. Don't have the same. And what if someone has 20 employees? Can they all of a sudden create a new corporation that they've... And I said, you know what? It's going to cost them a lot in legal fees and all to do that. They may as well just pay the workers.
Well, I think that we attempted to cover many bases, and there will always be places for loopholes and folks that mm-hmm. are looking to skirt the law. But we hope that most folks will understand what a benefit this is to the overall economy, with 70% of the economy being based upon things that consumers purchase. So those types of things will be beneficial to the economy as a whole, because as the minimum wage goes up, those workers will be spending more money, and it will grow the economy.
That's true.
I believe it was Henry Ford that over 100 years ago said that if I create a car, it makes no sense for me to create a car that my workers can't afford it.
That's right.
So he paid one of the highest wages in the industry, and that helped grow the first wave of the mechanized society and the Industrial Revolution. So I think that this is just the next phase of that.
Yeah, and I hope, you know, employers understand how important it is that their employees are able to make a living wage.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, again, if your mind is not right when you come to the office because you're struggling to pay the bills, productivity is going to be on the low end. And so they should understand that now, you know, the worker coming in, the mindset has changed.
Absolutely.
Because they understand, okay, my employer is willing to give me what I need
Absolutely.
To make it in life so that I can come to work. Mm-hmm. There's too often people who cannot afford to pay the bus fare or the train fare to get to work because they have to choose. Mm-hmm. You know, how do I get to work? So I'm hoping that employees will embrace this. You know, so Louis, again, thank you for talking about minimum wage, paid family leave, education, those aspects of our budget.
Anytime.
So now that the budget is over, what are you going to do?
It's now time to do all of the other work, everything else that happens after the budget. Just because we do the budget doesn't mean that our work is done.
It's done.
As a matter of fact, we have a committee meeting coming up in 4 days that will take up all of the non-budgetary items that have fiscal implications. So if someone says it's a great idea for us to ensure that every park has extra rangers or things of that sort, that has a cost
it has
to
a
it.
Cost.
So we have to assess any bill that comes through the legislature that would have a cost associated with it, and then make a recommendation to the senators on how they should approach it and how we should pay for it.
Yeah, and as you know, I'm always coming asking for something in my district. You know, and I'll be coming to you again, coming next week, saying, Louis, you know, my district needs XYZ, how can we fund it? Yep. You know, and I'm always appreciative of you, of your responses and your willingness to help me. And again, I thank you for being here today. And this has been Senator Roxanne J. Persaud, reporting from Albany, in the Legislative Report with Louis Tobias. Thank you and have a good day.